Go ahead.
War in the mind for the territory, for the dominion. We will dominate the opinions, schisms, and isms, keeping us in forms of religion, conforming our vision to the world church's decision, trapping a section, submitted to committee election, moral infection, epidemic lies and deception, insurrection, of the highest possible order distort, and I take recorders from hearing like underwater, beyond the borders, find ascending disorder, bound by the strategy of systemic depravity.
Like Warren says, it's freedom time. This is the war with the mind over territory where we at the war with the psychological destruction of deferred norms, the procedure of traditional debate, never taught to engage in liberation and escape. Who will dominate the opinion, the oppressor of the people, holding us to the prism of the topic steeple? Me, the resistance systemic depravity before expressing all humanity. Debate teaching us to defend America's exception, assimilating us to your such a cultural deception, leaving us with self-hatred and a lack of true self-perception. We need to engage in strategy to defy the imperial eye, see what truth comes, we are taught not to hear, and this activity tells us to fear it. This activity, like the other institutions of society, has grown from the roots of white supremacy. The methods of debate reflect white ways of viewing the world and white ways of knowing. This method is presented in a privileged, illusionary fiat fantasy line that's uncritical of racism and white supremacy. Shell K. Hill wrote an article of black participation in this community in 97 that debate is like the public speaking classroom. It's grounded in Western ideology, frowned upon African American communication style. This act makes it hard to recruit African Americans to this activity, or African Americans to this activity as if like the opposite of what we believe in. And it becomes difficult to act for competitors to stay in this activity when it is must suppress or give up cultural beliefs in order to be successful. An eternal struggle can emerge when an African American competitor finds that debate requires an approach that is not conducive to the image of African Americans. We see the Western ideology that's rampant in this activity as a white aesthetic that makes the white body in existence the ideal invader who is normative. This is exactly the same type of argument for white critical teams that are able to gain more access to people of color within this activity. Furthermore, Peggy McIntosh writes an article unpacking the visible aesthetic of privilege that whites are taught they get, thinking their lives is more like neutral, normative, ideal, and so ideal that when they work to benefit others, it's work to allow them to be more like us. This makes white supremacy and the white aesthetic invisible, unnamed political system made the modern world what it is today. Charles Mills in 97. White supremacy is an unnamed political system that made the modern world what it is today. You do not find this term an introductory or advanced textual course under political theory. A standard of undergraduate course will start off with Plato or Aristotle, though it covers more than 2,000 years of Western political thought. There is no mention of the actual basic political system that has changed the modern world for the past over 100 years. And this submission is not accidental. Rather, it reflects that the standard textbooks and courses have been mostly in part written and designed by whites who take their racial privilege home for granted. They don't even see it as a political, as a form of domination. Ironically, system of a domination at which people, white people, have historically ruled over and in certain important ways continue to rule over non-white people is not seen as a political system at all. It is taken for granted. It is a background in which other systems which we see are political are highlighted. Also, we also see that in this debate activity when Fort Hayes says and made an act at the beginning of this round to strike Shannara Reed, we think that it's fully offensive and exclusionary. This is for Shannara, this is for Shantaya, this is for Liz and Tanya, Jennifer Ebony, Whitney, Chartreuse, and Juanita, and all the black women in this activity. I speak for no one except for the millions of African-American women who were selected for the white command and the desert to be raped repeatedly, sometimes left in their own blood. I speak for no one except for the millions of African-American women aboard those ships that felt compelled to murder their own beautiful babies and infants who would never experience the nightmare of enslavement. I speak for no one except for Ida B. Wells, W.B. Du Bois, Frederick Douglass, all the black people who begged and petitioned the American government to intercede and stop white people from wantonly beating, murdering, lynching, and breaking and paralyzing black women and black men and black children. The government did nothing to take an actual toll in this actual stance. We feel that the position that they felt the strike Shannara Reed was an offensive reason that we feel that it's exclusionary. We feel that this debate activity has always excluded black women from being judges and outriders. We feel that their act was one that fucked up this type of rhetoric. We feel that we cannot build a coalition of politics within this realm and to address those fundamental issues of white supremacy as well as whiteness in this activity. Tim Wise writes in 2005, I say this process is white because the experience appeals the way white folks, especially African ones, typically forward and view the world of debate. English is repugnant to people of color for the same reason. White folks have a luxury of looking at life and death issues of war, peace, famine, unemployment, and criminal justice is just a game. So for the engagement to actually debate, for example, whether or not full employment is a good idea, create racial profiling is bad or not, it's already a white identified act. Some of the main practices that have become structural in order to perpetuate the whitest act is one, so reliance on traditional office was an act of taking of having a credibility, taking over personal narratives and music, lived experiences, and make arguments to tell us that the only people that have knowledge here is PhDs, JHDs, and MD authors that have this is epistemology bankrupt. Two is the science of the issue of white supremacy, how it's functioning, essentially shaping this debate activity, norms, and procedures. Another one is the highly competitive nature where you can strike people that are of the different races that you don't have to engage in on a regular basis. Four is the use of objective disconnected narratives, which creates an assumed fair standards to apply to everyone in the context of debate. The black aesthetic is the production of the ultimate difference that subverts the boundary as a competition. Nelson in 98. While this seems to be the more controlled force model is both and solution to either or dilemma, it's actually more dangerous to the dilemma itself. All too often due to both and names, the moment of complete assimilation to erasure the African American others altogether. This is conveniently closes down the complex web of debate, totalizing this moving over all categories involved. To take account for the culture becoming, we cannot go from the dialectic separation of either or to the dialectic assimilation of both and. Rather, we need to critical vocabulary to open up the movement becoming to enact the specificity to the difference, a repetition with a difference. To describe this open-ended movement transformation, then we need a force that goes not only to either or but in both and, but as either or, not the difference of assimilation, but the difference to difference to difference. The ballot politics, a ballot for us is the better ruptures the very metaphysics that they are seeking to transform in a way that has a possibility for transforming the material conditions that are formed by the epistemology and the ideologies or ontologies that they actually criticize. We must actually embrace the framework that addresses the claims of the root cause of white supremacy, and this is Mills in 97. He says the global theoretical what is needed is a global theoretical framework for situated discussion of race and white racism, thereby challenging the subject of white political philosophy. In other words, the recognition that racism, global white supremacy, and the subject of political system or peculiar power structure of informal and formal rule. Our framework for the debate is that David and I believe debate should be about the liberation of the press and changing conditions of this white supremacist activity. Our framework is best engaged in consistent practice and advocacy advances the liberation of the press. Larry Neal, former philosopher of the Black Arts Movement, writes in a journal review in 1968, said the white Western aesthetic has run its course. It's impossible to try anything meaningful within this decaying structure. We advocate a cultural revolution in art and ideas. The cultural values inherent in Western history must either radicalize or destroy, but probably find a radicalization is impossible. In fact, what is needed is a whole new system of ideas. Thus, the advocates for this run is that Dayvon and I believe that the debate community should embrace a revolutionary aesthetic in order to destroy the dominant Western white aesthetics. We personally have a social location of being Black, so we feel that the Black aesthetic is the way that we can actually address these type of harms that we talk about specific to this community. Larry Neal further sheds lights on this advocacy. He said the motive behind the Black aesthetic is the destruction of the white thing, destruction of white ideas, white ways of looking at the world. The new aesthetic is primarily predicated on the ethics that ask the questions, whose vision of the world is finally more meaningful, ours or white oppressors, what is truth, or precisely whose truth shall be expressed, that of the oppressor of the oppressors. The debate would be actually become a space where we orient ourselves towards the method of liberation and justice. Resolutions would not be solely focused on the United States federal government and to do certain actions, but we have academics and agency. As academics, we can use our agency to change the conditions in society within this debate activity as well. People of color would not feel the trauma, the psychic trauma of the white gaze when we present a policy that liberates the oppressed, perceive objective notions and standards of what we can, not the only the only criteria that we use to evaluate grounds. The education producing will relate to the self and be about how one lives and how one behaves and how they can actually endorse a plan of action to change the fundamental conditions of white supremacy and racism in society. Picking judges wouldn't be so hard because there wouldn't be a strong white male bias on the actual performance of the white ideal body, which is a somatic norm that is embedded within its activity. These would be introductory visions of debate instead of propping up the peerless agendas of role-playing the oppressor that will be actually exported to large societies, Hispanos and Joe Miller's book of cross-sex. He says, I am very much aware that the arrogant neocons in that century of the Bush administration learned the disinterested argument of skills in high school and college debate societies that quality become the basis of disarmament and justify the oppressed. This type of leadership reproduces itself along with the invisible oppression that is perpetuated as long as the training ground debate protocols from which the merger remains intact, a revolution and debate must actually occur. So we feel with the Black aesthetic as the writers of the Young Gal moving toward the Black aesthetic as Fuller writes in his article towards the Black aesthetic. The Black aesthetic is a way of perceiving the world through a unique lens of experience of the militant self-aware African American is a way of perceiving form as more than just simplistic beauty. So we feel that we must advocate a Black aesthetic within this debate community in order to challenge the dominant white aesthetic in order to break down some of the norms, the procedures, and exclusionary practices that the negative engages in as well as this community. I said nothing for cross-sex.
Do you think I'm a white male?
I don't know what you are.
So you're going to impute motives that we are racist because of other
I never said you were racist.
Trying to call us out for how we should.
I called you out for actually striking Shanera because I feel in this activity, Black women and women in general don't always get the judge out rounds. And we feel that Black women have a special, unique place that are always excluded within this activity.
Look, I really like what you guys are doing. I really like what you're talking about.
Sure you did.
But how can you make the claims that our strike sheet represents a form of racism in a world where you don't know the reasons for why we do it? You don't ever talk to us about it, you never ask
okay,
us about
that's
it.
What it's the biggest
you want to get in a room full of tons of people and you want to call us out, you want to call us racist.
We didn't call you racist. We said you were exclusionary for the act that you took. And your act actually has racist implications, not that you yourself are racist.
But my question is, why did you start to want to see depicting us as your enemy instead of your allies fighting with you?
We definitely did not.
If you want this revolution, why don't you allow us to be part of it?
We did not depict you as enemies. What we're saying is
the way that you engage in the revolution, then we have to challenge those. If we see something that's problematic, and exclusion of people of color is something that will make a revolution problematic.
Is excluding people of color necessarily worse than excluding other minorities?
Look, it's not about other minorities right now. We're not trying to play oppression Olympics. What we're saying is that your act of exclusion of Shanara Reed in this round is one that represented exclusion of black people in this activity.
Yeah, okay, so if we would have excluded Omar from this round, would that somehow made us...
Look, we're not saying no and or if scenario. What we're saying is your exact act.
And attempted to call us out, call us racist, and say that we're exclusionary
without knowing anything. Look, we can concede that Omar may actually benefit from male privilege. What we're saying is that Shanara Reed is one woman that you excluded from this actual judging panel.
If you agree that there needs to be more inclusion in this...
How many other people were excluded from this...
Fine, but other people did not get the chance. They were not on the strike sheet. Shanara Reed was on the strike sheet, and we felt that she should have had a chance to have her voice heard in this round.
And my question is, why didn't you discuss with us beforehand about this argument?
Like, we had a good relationship all year. Like, we talk about our arguments together and things like that. We talk about, like, the problems that we have in this community
We're not saying that we hate you. We're definitely allies with you. But we think that the fact that you excluded...
Why do you call us out by name?
Because of the fact of what you did, you excluded a black woman from a judging panel. I don't see why you don't think that it's a big problem. Seeing as though this community is not full of black women, this community barely has black women actually judging the out rounds, yet alone women.
Sure, and I'm not quite sure there'll be reasons for that coming out. But
okay, sure. And we're sure, we're probably sure that strategic reasons.
And why did you strike Brent Sandin?
Look, we
debated for your coach coached him. That's a pretty reasonable
decision.
Every night I have the same dream. A man behind the door with a tattooed erection and no reflection. Every night I have the same dream. Madonna's at the crossroads, dressed like future spies. They shine their lips with android sperm. Every night I have the same dream. White crows in an empty sky. When I call, they descend. The young trees bend, and the dream is always dry. Diaries celebrate ritual. Cerebrate, heroin. Jim chooses shooting horse over shooting hoops, or horse chooses him. Pascal's dream, a painter who every night dreamed she was a king, is a king who every night dreamed he was a painter. Every day I have a different dream. We labor every day in the landmark. The landmark for the fort. Renovating landmarks is slow work. Revealing layers of limestone, of fungus, termites, decay, of a fungus, thick, bright, technicolored, even enough to scare the most heroic doser. Yes! Dread dredges, food of the gods, from the gods, but this is ridiculous. In ancient Athens, Athena rode through the streets in a chariot of fire. Gods walk the earth because gods walk the earth. Only a god can save us now. Fritz and Martin dance eternally. Fritz on God's grave, Martin at his Black Forest altar. We labor every day in a landmark, in Sheridan's shadow, at debate's altar, awaiting neither God nor God, son of Sam, son of a fuck, but then who is it? In utero, in vitro, in for a penny, why not pound another nail or two for the cause, another nail in God's coffin? If only God can save us now, might be time to call out the dogs, a symphony of canine advice on killing prostitutes, killing vice, this place is killing me. We labor every day under the onus of fungus. Under the weight of God's food, inhaled, not ingested, invitations not easily refused. Wonder why God's chosen chose this land, why God promised their land, why God never chose us when picking sides for basketball. With God on your side, doing God's work, no obstacle too large, no cost too high, no genocide too great. Allah be praised, Hosanna in the highest. Yahweh lights the way, while Sheridan backtrails to villages, empty to borders, filled with easy pickings. Major General Jomo sacks, pillages, scouts, rapes, slices, dices, delivers the Midwest, delivers on a promise, delivers the promised land to the chosen people. Our numbers up, eviction papers came in the visage of the architect, hell bent on preservation, renovation, rejuvenation, gut pickings, spill Sheridan's guts. We labor every day in a landmark, landmark with blood. Red blood spilled by the red-blooded still spills so much blood. Seems like the mark of red-bloodedness is spilling blood. Southeast Asian blood, South American blood, South Pacific blood, Nazi, fascist, communist, terrorist blood. So much blood spilled on the promised land, so much promise unfulfilled, too much bloodlust fulfilled. We labor every day in a landmark, ringed with limestone, singed by ferocious fungi, and is burdened by a century lived among the ghosts of centuries past, slaughtered so that so many could learn, burden shared with learners, ignorant of owed debts, lives lived in blissed out innocence of lives lost for promises made by a dead god, destiny made manifest in the villagers' visages, filled with horror, hatred bred of occupation, nurtured through massacre, stoked by the fire set with backstabbers, track back trails of exiting warriors, a sure sign, resistance is futile, assimilation dangled, citizenship offered, submit, submerge, trail tears without reserve, removed to reservations, assured forever, unless fuel found, coal that is, black gold, Shoshone tea, maps overlaid, laid over Indian country like addiction's tracks running across the veins of nuclear junkies, laying bare uranium veins, laying waste to land, promise to the people, not God's chosen, but Turtle Island's first, why God never chose them when choosing sides for holy wars. Every night I have the same dream. We labor in a landmark, under obligation's weight, through a fungus fog, new refrigerator after the previous generation's suicide, likely out of shame for our course, shifting under Sheridan's shadow, obligation's onus, a solar anus spewing poisonous particulates, like shamans drinking acolyte's urine, poisons purged, potency ensured, inhaled, not ingested, insidious, irresistible, moths drawn to fiery deaths, debaters drawn with very fine camel hair brushes, broad strokes for the bright lights, like the fringe of light from within, with the fire down below, down to the short strokes, gripped by the short hairs, hair of the dog, biting my ass again. A word to the wise, apparently insufficient. Here we go again. I open the fridge, way too frigid. Itso's garage, indeed, shining bright. At the back, almost reach it. Little help, boost from Avery, probably a little too late. Still slipping, sliding, way too frigid. Like Sid's Ice Age, sliding ice tunnel, images tumble, tracings truths, tracers lighting the way. Ice melts, tunnel lens, a torrent of ice water. Falling, falling, water warms, falls, whirls me in a pool. Idyllic, reflecting waterfalls, rock, sun, sky, not me. Naturally, I check, tattooed and direct. Marvelous detail, I marvel. In the distance, a dog barks and I follow the sound. Across a mountain meadow, lush, green, beautiful. When I crest the berm, a shepherd, by the looks of his flock, not that I'm staring or anything, a shepherd falling asleep while his sheep forage. Do androids dream of electronic sheep? Do shepherds dream of android sperm? Deep asleep, awakened when a long, thick snake crawls into his throat, choking, gagging, dog barking furiously. I arrive just after another, antiquated dress, bowler hat, bushy mustache, long forehead, mischievous, sparkling eyes, a wink to me, a knowing smile and a voice that booms across the meadow. Bite, bite, bite! Instructions shattered to an outblue shepherd chewing on chestnuts dropped from trees planted by sages ages ago. Time's conundrum? Bite or choke? The shepherd bites hard, spews the asp head, gasps, gulps, disappears in his place. A gateway. Moment. Without hesitation, bushy mustache shakes off the previously undetected debaters, sitting on his back, dripping lead in words, traces of molten lead dripping down his collar, trailing down debaters' chins from shading grins. Once dethroned, trails off in search of rocks hidden behind bushes. Hot on capital T truth trail, hot off the presses that surely possesses nothing but the truth. So help them God, Hosanna in the highest. I leap through the doorway before it disappears, too long to follow the other one who travels back to Sylvania's flat rock, awaiting another of Zarathustra's visits. I off to another land. A different promise to Allah's children, from the Midwest to the Middle East, America's center to Central Asia. Darkness surrounds, but caves' mouths reveal mountains, and fires illumine Allah's armies, bowing, praying, facing east towards the Kaaba at Mecca. Face east, fear west, fight the worst of God's chosen. With God on all our sides, annihilation assured, rest assured, Armageddon at hand. I have a dream, the same dream every night, but the dream is always dry. I stumble in the dark towards the firelight, fall into the fire's light, fall out of faith, into hellfire, burning flesh, eternally. Where would you rather spend eternity? Listening to hellfire and brimstone at God's right hand, or dancing to hell's holy choir, screeching electric guitar music, Jimmy's guitar permanently ablaze, synapses firing, bullets flying, on my belly, lying soaked in a southeast paddy, sounds like cicadas, human, dense, dank, boilers, too dark, can't see the trees for the forest, can't see the forest for the jungle, out of differences light, out of the jungle's clearing, out of forest, into paddy's pad, I, paddy's as far as the eye can see, out of sight, out of mind, time out of mind, out from humanitas, across rivers, never the same twice, Beacon Hill, Bunker Hill, like an emperor, I came, I oversaw, I conquered, emperors on a hill, overlooking fiefdoms, mapmaker standing on a mountain, overlooking hills, historian standing in libraries, looking over maps, reigning in disciplines, reigning on parades, struggling for imperialism, dizzying distant frontiers, shattering local contours, room spins, faces blur, bodies merge, out of many, one, from none, all, a book for all, a book for no one. Crowds cheer, tents collapse, darkness cobwebs, darkness and cobwebs, fire reflects a hallucinatory gauze, words on walls, chains abyssal, bombs drop, people drop, villages burn, cities burn, too many, too many. Let's disparage, lose sight, as if insight bears insight. Bear little witness, lay bare wounds, wounds covered over tactically. In the distance, our dog barks, and our topic gags, bites, spews, and the night gives way to light, bright light. Here comes the sunshine, California, here we come. Generations gaze follows, night falls, prayers end, arms gathered, alms always already elsewhere. Unhummed, unmapped drop, too many. Out further into the night, same nightmare, different list. Frankfurt, Tokyo, Los Angeles, NYC, blood flows, seas parted, reverie startled. Solutions so simple, must be a dream. From every mountaintop, freedom rings. Too many checks returned, marked insufficient, masking malice, liberty gags, bites, fuse. South Africa must be free. Walls collapse, fear returns eternally. Blonde beasts, fallen bears, Islam occupied, intelligence lost, agency found. Without agents, history ends, descent withers, winners win. W hides a rock behind a bush and can't find it. Fritz rides a boat on the water and calls it woman. Politicians stand on shores as plans crash like waves. Planes crash like firebombs, towers raised. Red-blooded blood runs like rivers through the gutters. Hatred, patriotism raised. Afghanistan raised. Shock and awe. Shock and fucking awe. Baghdad raised. Bunkers busted. Bush busted out. Washed clean by cannibal blood and baptismal water. Reborn. Sin shorn. Flesh torn. Debate argues abysses. Courage slays dizziness. Giddiness at the edge of abysses. And debating always debates abysses. Look into the abyss, and the abyss looks back into you. Beware. Dynamite thinking easily pounded, impossibly forgotten. Writing, reading, hearing abysses demands courage. Access is bold as love. Wind cries Mary. And door opens and abrupt stops the music just as the timer goes off. Hey Joe, don't forget your gun. This is my rifle, this is my gun. This is for fighting, this is for fun. Ready, set, your turn.
Why didn't you speak to your exclusion of Shannara in this round?
I think that the cross-examination kind of talked about that. We can, like, we'll probably end up talking about it more too.
I want to know now.
Like, if you want to know, like, I mean, like, I think that there are reasons beyond, like, race.
What
did this happen? And if you boil it down to an issue of race, you're making a very complicated issue.
I think you're misinterpreting the argument. We're not saying just about race. We're saying you excluded her. Now we're asking you, why did you do that? We're asking you now. This is cross section. Ask the question,
dude. If you seriously want to know, because we don't think it would be strategic to us, not because it would be a black person on the panel or anything like that, but because of
the
debate round in the debates that we've had in the past with Shannara in the back of the room against you specifically and the specific theories that we invoke.
What about that? But then Shannara said, in order to win her ballot, you have to make a connection to people of color with your highly theoretical methods of postmodernism. Why can you do that and have her in the back of the room?
Dude, to boil it down, this is the reason that we have even preferences and things like that, to boil it down to, like, one specific issue or something like that, where, like, I don't think that
gets at, like, let me ask a question. So, and if you agree that there needs to be more inclusion in the activity, right? Don't you think that would have been a step in the direction of increasing that type of inclusion that you say?
It's not arbitrary. Like, that's the point. Like, just the idea that there would be more, more participation by any group, any marginalized group.
All right, that's fine.
Like, while that's necessarily good, that doesn't mean that we have to arbitrarily
do that. But at the same time, how many times do you have the opportunity to have a black woman judge you in out rounds? How many times in your debate career have you ever had a black woman
Seriously, if you're going to make this debate about preferences, then I think that
it's not about preferences. I'm asking you, when have you ever had a black woman judge you in out rounds this far in a damn tournament?
Dude, we haven't been this far in a tournament, dude.
Okay. That's fine. The farthest that you've ever been, have you ever had a black woman in the back of the room?
I don't think so, and I do think that is a fucked up part of our community.
Well, why didn't you let her judge this round?
It's just like, why did that press say it? Was it because he's white and you didn't want
right.
a white judge?
We damn sure it wasn't.
Exactly.
I mean,
what we're saying is that
we think we have enough men on the damn panel. What we're saying is that we want more inclusion of black women and women in general. Tony Nielsen's on the panel, fine, we definitely love that. And we think there's more inclusion of black women's voices need to be in this activity. Now, why did you make the decision to do that? It was just purely strategic?
Dude, it's about specific things that are going to be happening.
What specific things?
Jesus.
What specific things?
What specific things?
Yes, I'm listening.
We had a round that we thought that we won. We didn't think you had an answer to.
It smells like protection of white privilege.
We don't think that's true. We're the team, but one of the teams that tried to argue against that so hard.
pain on paper.
Pain on paper.
This is me losing my brain on paper.
Brain on paper.
This is me going insane trying to explain my pain on paper. This is my repentance, this soul's application to the Savior. And they say, don't call us, we'll call you. And this is my idle time until the Lord asks for me. This is my attempt at blasphemy. This is my cleaning, my vaccination, my pleading, my explanation, falling short of my aspirations and goals. This is my pain on paper.
This is my pain on paper. This is poetry. Now this is spoken word, spoken through open source, spoken through broken vocal cords. This is the prequel to the sequel, the anger of the unequal. This is the bleach to a white tee. This is the peace sign to a t-shirt that says kill white tee. This is the cure to jungle fever. This is the video game that made the White House resident evil.
We're already the beer coming out of the 1AC. We talk about the ways in which imperialism affects the conditions, particularly in this clip and the clip that my partner played in the 1AC of Wilmore Hill, that talks about the ways in which the systemic depravity will spread to all humanity if we don't change the conditions and the institutions that perpetuate the oppression that we talk about. We're already that mirror. We've already engaged in that. And an interesting thing about the concept of a mirror is that the only thing that isn't reflected back in a mirror, the only light that isn't reflected back is darkness. And this is something that is excluded. The clip that I just played, this clip about Archie the Messenger and Lyrical Lyricists are folks, the discourses that are oftentimes hidden and excluded as a result of the hegemony that white Western political philosophy has maintained in this society. This is the new evidence that talks about the lack of meaningful discourses that can come out of the white aesthetic and what's necessary is a challenge to the very ideologies in this activity that cause a disinterest in argumentative skills that don't allow us to transform the conditions that exist. Now, our argument is that this kind of doubling doesn't actually has an atemporal and ahistorical methodology that doesn't have any way to actually have a political or doesn't have a political mechanism for implementing the ways in which these conditions can transform society. There's no particular way in which they transform the very thing that the Mills evidence suggests is the root of all types of oppression. It talks about the fact that white supremacy is the political system from which all others are highlighted and that the system of domination from which white people continue to rule over the world is the system of politics that we live in today. Nothing about the ideology, nothing about the methodology of the 1NC was able to transform the very existence of white supremacy as that political system from which all others are highlighted. As a result, this means that we have the best chance of transforming the conditions in our society. We talk about revolutionary aesthetics, and from our particular social location, the black aesthetic, that gives us the ability to use our subjectivity as a means to change the type of white supremacy epistemology that comes out of the lack of centrality of white supremacy that comes, and even a lot of the postmodern fears that the negative uses oftentimes. And our argument is that we have to challenge the ways in which these ontologies exist, but challenge them in a way that is conscious of the way in which racialized subjectivity happens as a result of white supremacy in the society. Also, if you think about the role of the battle, they make this argument that this doubling, our argument is that the way in which we engage in this debate, in our particular argumentation, the way in which we engage in revolutionary aesthetics, and us, Deven and I in particular, best break down the type of ontologies they seek to resist. Because black people being able to get to semis of CEDA nationals, the arguments that we're making best ruptures the type of ontologies that cause the oppression and imperialism that exists right now. And so for that reason, if we're talking about the role of the battle, the role of the battle is who best ruptures the ontologies that create the type of oppression that we talk about. And as a result, this means that we have the best way to transform the conditions that cause a lot of things that the 1NC talks about and the things that Archie the Messenger and Lyrical the Lyricists are talking about. What's also important is that the fact that Shannara Reed was excluded on the spreadsheet, the argument here is that if we recognize that there is a need for inclusion in the activity, then we have to make specific actions in order to make sure that inclusion happens. It was an opportunity for Ford Hayes to be able to include her in the discussion to make this discussion more fruitful. This isn't an argument about them being racist. This is an argument about a methodology that they chose to pick to not include Shannara in the discussion that is necessary. And if they agree that inclusion is an important part in being able to effectively challenge these forms of domination, then that inclusion was necessary. And what's interesting about it is that Shannara is very well versed in post-structuralist and post-colonial literature, which is the vein of literature that they use and have used to debate against us and gave them advice about how to make that post-modern and post-structural theory to be able to relate to us, to be able to debate us. And so what she's asking for and what the negative failed to do is be able to make that connection. This isn't a question of their sincerity or a question of their intentions. This is a question of their methodology, and their methodology was problematic in the way in which they struck her. I need the time. I forgot to start.
You got 4:20 left.
Also, Watts in 2005 says that until debate is substantially diversified so that previously ignored voices will have the chance to be heard on their own terms and with their own styles, little will change. What debate needs most is the infusion of persons who know full well that the system is anything but fair. Debate, it will never change in this way unless the gatekeepers of this activity are prepared to step up and demand that it's not just their words, not just with their words, but with their actions and their ballots. Folks of color and working class folks don't join the activity if they feel the wisdom isn't going to be taken seriously. If they want to be ignored, they can just stay home and get ignored because the powerful ignore them every day anyway. So this speaks to the power of the ballot and its ability to recognize the very folks who are needed in this activity. Your ballot in this round serves as the purpose for validating one of the two Semitic norms that I talked about, that we talked about in the one you see, the Semitic norms that allow the white body to be the normative body from which all other things are equated to. What's also problematic about the theory that they engage in is they engage in what we call ideal theory. Mills in 2007 says ideal theory is thus likely to seem more evasive or just irrelevant. It seems to me that the proponents of ideal theory face a dilemma. Either the ideal theory is not ultimately intended to assist in the determination of justice in a non-ideal world, or it's intended to do so. If the former, then this, of course, would only confirm the worst suspicions of the critics of ideal theories and essentially exercise the voice away from the real intercourse with the world. The latter, in the case, is intended to be practically useful in the world, then it surely ideal theorists would owe us an account of why, how little work has been produced in the thousands of articles over the past few decades on such an application, especially as respect to race, and also what bridging concepts that would be supposed to assist in this application. This basically talks about the ways in which their ideal theory doesn't interact with the material conditions that exist in the world that allow us to be able to transform the conditions that exist. Also, these highly dense theoretical texts oftentimes don't allow the methodology for people of color and people specifically who are suffering, who don't have access to the institutions, to understand the kind of hyper-theoretical language that they use access to be able to challenge the forms of domination in this society. This is Hooks in 1990. It is sadly ironic that the contemporary discourse, which talks about the homogeneity and decentered subject declaring breakthroughs through a line of recognition of others, still directs a critical voice primarily to specialized audience and one that shares a common language rooted in a very similar mass narrative that they claim to challenge. We show my postmodern critical inquiry is centered precisely on the issues of difference and otherness. On the purely theoretical plane, the inspiration of these concepts has produced some important results, but in the absence of any substantial research on what artists of color and others outside the mainstream might be up to in such discussions, it becomes rootless instead of radical. At the point where the framework is that who best engages in the consistent practice and advocacy that advances the liberation of the oppressed, what this means is that we have the best methodology to engage in the struggle for liberation so that we can transform the conditions in our society. Also, the Nealon evidence in my partner recently when he talks about how blackness, that usually a black aesthetic already ruptures the binaries from which they say are already imposed on us. So this infusion of blackness and the use of the black aesthetic ruptures the binaries that rupture the type of ontologies that we seek to eradicate. Also, the Nealon evidence coming out of the 1AC was also conceded this is that nothing meaningful can come out of the white aesthetic. At the point where the 1AC is participating in that white aesthetic, at the point where this is the case, this means that they don't have the ability to transform the conditions that exist in society because of their lack of a methodology and the abstractness and the ideal theory from which comes out of Western European authors, European theorists that oftentimes aren't situated in the spaces where they are the ones who are being subject to colonialism. Also, as a result of the fact that they engage in the exclusionary extraction narrative, this also becomes a link to the white aesthetic because it maintains the lack of discussion of people of color in this discourses and therefore create the invisibility that exists. Also, white supremacy is a tool of war and eco crisis. It's wise in 2006. It is an American form of white supremacy still as its predecessor rooted in the decolonization of people, good and bad, responsible and irresponsible, which leads nations like the United States to believe themselves the types of the resources of the earth. They all resources beneath the sands of Iraq or the coal deposits in the West Virginia mountains. South. That entitlement mentality proceeds to derive for profit and helps the place in its proper context. That same mentality then contributes to the world's ecological predicament, including the global climate change, soil and wetland erosion, political pollution, polluted drinking water, air, related health effects of all these. The Spanos evidence talks about the ways in which this activity creates a neoconservative agenda that causes oppression. When we embrace the revolutionary aesthetics against this activity, the pedagogy can become effective in challenging domination in the conditions that we all agree exist.
So do you agree that the 1AC is a double of the 1AC?
No, we were already that before you did it.
Okay, so that you don't recognize anything in the 1AC as being a principle then, is your argument?
No, I mean, why put a mirror in front of a mirror? That's infinitely aggressive.
What exactly are you mirroring? You just said we are a mirror, and then you explained your argument. How is that a mirror?
We're the mirror of the way in which this world operates, especially as it relates to oppression and domination. Like
you're,
we already
you're reflecting what? The community? What are you reflecting?
We're reflecting what society is projecting on us. We're already that mirror that seeks to transform. I mean, we're the mirror direct that helps us recognize
what, okay, and what happens from that experience?
It gives us, well, as the revolutionary aesthetics argues, it gives us the ability to effectively challenge the white aesthetic that suppresses the ability of individuals,
particularly people of color, to change. Why does the mirroring lead to that? I see why your 1AC would do that, but why is this?
I mean, it solves, basically in debate terms, it solves for the offense of this mirroring argument.
Your argument is that the 1AC did it itself. Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Why do you win for this? Like, I don't see necessarily why you wouldn't. Like, we agree on so much. I mean, there's definitely some, like, some other things in this round that we don't. However, like, we agree on so much. Why can't we say yes to what you say? Why do
you, like, you can, like, but we don't have to.
Because you didn't, you can't
because you didn't
because
say yes to Shannara. That's
because
why.
People come in and play the oppressor and things like that. The why when we come in the round not play the oppressor?
Our reason is saying that you said no to Shannara is just like functionally saying no to our black identity as well.
What's the difference between being racist at your core and having a racist methodology?
Because the methodology that you use excludes issues of race, and if white supremacy is a political system from which all others are highlighted, it requires addressing race centrally, or white supremacy centrally, and fighting it and combating it. The lack of that, like when you said it was strategic, like if you're really interested in inclusion, then it needs to be a conscious thought that Shannara is a black woman who reads a lot of the literature you read, maybe that perspective is useful in this debate.
Okay. And if it just so happens that there are three people who would happen to like our stuff more, then why? Like, why?
So this means that you're not really dedicated to the struggle against white supremacy.
Why?
Like, that. Like, if you're really that interested in it, then we have to take actions to do that. And our argument is that including Shannara in the discourse would have created a better ability to have to increase inclusion and have the dialogue that would make this debate better.
And on top of that, you still ain't even apologize for striking her.
Dude. We fucking love Shannara. I don't even know what you're talking about. That's the reason that she's one of our most pref critics. What is the West? What is the West?
We're talking about
You want to destroy the dominant white Western aesthetic. What is that Western aesthetic?
That
is
comes
it geographic?
Out of European colonial powers, including the United States
any,
as a descendant.
Like, any
from the
1AC,
we're talking
about
we're talking about from the 1AC as well as white ways of actually looking at the world. We think we should view the world through the eyes of the oppressed. That's why we think Shannara should have been another person within this judging panel.
Every day I go to school in the blood-soaked lands of Fort Hays State University. Every day I go to the school and I see the buildings named Custer, Sheridan, Hayes. Every day I go to school which glorifies the destruction of my people, my culture. My great-grandmother was so oppressed that she denounced her heritage that when I asked my grandfather what Asian I come from, what is my background, he says you're not a fucking Indian. He says you are French, that's why you have your high cheekbones. Has my culture been erased from me? Because of how they erase all race. Where are my people in the judging? Where is my petition even to have someone like that? Where is the ability for any kind of dishes, men or women, to get in the pool? The point is not whether or not we strike people. We love Shannara. Her Spectre is with us now, and she's one of our favorite critics. However, just because we're not pressed, one is not a reason for us to lose. It's not a reason why we are massive racist privilege. Why? Just because we view other people as being better for around for us than one person. It's not a form of merely being racist, though. Too many engagements things. Specifically, that we acknowledge the app is amazing. We realize we need to increase minority participation in debate, but it's not something we really reduce to a black-white binary. That is inherently exclusionary, which basically seems to alienate everyone. We must attempt to incorporate that activity of everyone. This activity needs the revolution. We have to challenge the invented Orient, the Africas, the Americas.
Okay, just time. You go. Alright, I guess we're
sitting
in
the
hospital. Alright. You want another 10 seconds? You want 5 seconds to regain the time?
Okay. How many did you have to talk about?
Count up, 7:40 go.
We see the racism of the West against us. The one in C is calling out of all forms of oppression and discrimination. It's the recognition of Islam and how it gets discriminated against American culture. It's how our foreign policy dictates where it exists the world versus the world of where in a way that we don't see the oceans of blood that came from our national our country being produced. We argument basically for the representation of not identity politics, not the identities that are imposed upon us by the colonizing West. I'm not Indian because that's what my people called me. I'm Indian because that was the label that's imposed upon us. This is our argument is we must engage in a form of struggle that is identity in politics, as Mandela writes in 2007. I will argue that identity in politics is crucial for any decolonial option, since without building political theories and organized political action that are grounded on identities that have been allocated, e.g., there were no Indians in the American continent until the arrival of Spaniards. There were no blacks until the beginning of the massive slave trade in the Atlantic. By the imperial discourse in the six languages of the European modernity, English, French, and German after the Enlightenment, Italian, Spanish, and Portuguese, during the Renaissance, it may not be possible to denaturalize the imperial racial construction of identity in the modern world under a capitalist economy. Identity is driven by European modern discourse. We're racial, that is colonial, racial matrix, and patriarchal. Faustino Reina, that our eminent intellectual activists clearly stated in the late 60s. I am not Indian, damn it. I'm Armenia, or Arimara. And when you make me Indian, and as an Indian, I will fight for liberation. Identity in politics in some ways is the only way to think decoloniality, which means to think politically in decolonial terms and projects. All other ways of thinking that is intervening in the organization of knowledge, understanding, all of acting politically, that is not decolonial, means to remain within the imperial reason. That is within the imperial reason of identity politics. We call not to embrace the notion based upon exclusive notions of identity, but we call to use those identities to them before it pushed upon us strategically, to use them in ways that allows for us to challenge the current forms. Merely saying that merely their claims are win based upon including merely serves to keep these binaries intact, and merely serves to keep things separated, where we can classify, basically, where we can classify individual forms for oppression over another, that basically there's a unique binary between white and black, them, and then that is really to hold all their claims to do that, and all their claims to do for voting for them is merely to invert that binary, to pull one over the other instead. Our argument is those binaries are inherently the problem. It's when we view things in binary terms as one over the other, we've basically included a few black people and everything's gonna be fine. Everything's not gonna be fucking fine if we do that. That's the point of saying that Louisville solved racism because they had two black women who were top speakers at CEDA 2 years ago. This is not the issue. The issue is we must challenge the force of how the base proves how it operates, how it addresses the binary threshold, and how it opposes an identity upon us. The act of signing the ballot and act for the app produces the critical implosion. That implosion produces space that challenges the last sacred cow. The constructed rules in CEDA that says there's no such thing as a double win or a double loss. We can't glorify the winning. See, we can't celebrate it. I refuse to come out and engage like the white privilege. What's your strategy to face the resistance attempts to annihilate them? I refuse to be their enemy. I refuse to fight against them. I say we should stand together. We should form coalitions. We need to challenge us, but we can't do that until we challenge the structures of debate. Thus, for we call for endorsing the entire of the YAC through the negative ballot. Not since the we are 4 days or endorsing 4 days, but you are endorsing the YAC in all of its glory, all of its amazingness, because it is true. And this is the act of science about producing this space that allows us to rethink why people are excluded from this activity. Why are there only a few forms of minorities in this route rounds? Why these questions are able to occur? It's because of how we can jump to activity in a way that's always going to be inherently binary, where the ballot is always going to be bad between the affirmative and the negative, and which we attempt to eventually destroy them in the fights and struggles. Our evidence is absolutely going to be phenomenal because of how we need to create the short circuit to implode this activity and actually challenge it, and undermine its perceptions. He rises just in three. A short circuit occurs by faulty connection to the network. From the standpoint of the network's smooth functioning, the ability to take the major classic text author notion and read from the short circuit away from the lens of a minor author text, or except apparatus, minor, large, less about the hegemonic ideology, this version can leave the insight to completely shatter under minor concepts. This reading achieves the inherent decentered interpretive text and brings light its unthought. It's about presumptuous consequences. Short circuits intend to revive a practice of reading which confronts a classic text author notion with its own hidden presumptuous. Thus reveals this is now true. The point is to make her aware of another disturbing side of something he or she knew all along. We call to implode this activity of debate, to expose the debate can be more than just merely an affluent which is driven by the logic of competition between one side has to dominate the other, or one side has to be privileged above the other. The one I see act is phenomenal. The problem is in the twisting and how they attempt to pit us against their alliance, and how they de-differentiate the West to construct the European non-European binaries. This basically is an attempt to basically exclude our subconscious argument. The reason the Western theory is hegemonic, the reason that the West is wrong is because it's steeped in its privilege, because it doesn't see the rivers of blood and the suffering of what the dominant power structures have produced. The history of Eastern and Central Europe's subjugation of the Cold War, the people labored under the history of the Iron Curtain. It was not merely the United States oppression, but it was the so-called Eastern, or the so-called Eastern and the Asian, the Russian communists that were basically always going to be the problem. They were the ones that were oppressing. The Punch theory stands against that form of oppression that Russia imposed upon them. The Soviet Union considered the East, essentially as a merging superpower, was between the hegemony. They refused the history of the Cold War because the West is a European. Because they demonize the West as inherently always being bad, and always just basically then to all the beauty of the what the YC has, the really coalitions, the courting minority participation debate inherently destroys itself. The revolution against the collapse and against the revolution. Sorry, the argument is that we shouldn't use those theories. The use of theory is not inherently hegemonic, but instead we use it to embrace, exalt, and celebrate the act. Not using it as a hegemonic thing, but saying privilege our theory and ignore their arguments. Arguments that we can use our theory and challenging the forms of debate, doubling the debate to create that critical implosion where we blow up the bar between the affirmative and the negative. We can destroy those forms of how competition operates and allow to challenge things. Our sincere is brought together, she is inherently a Slovenian, and when she came from a hinterly totalitarian society where they were not allowed to have academic freedom, only the privileged were allowed to be in the schools to be educated, and that she is inherently limited to what the school, what the country wanted you to know. This is the historical oppression of peoples that aren't allowed to debate with. This is exactly what Plunge talks about, how we can overcome those structures. All the people that basically fought one another in Slovenia. And then the Soviet Union comes in and makes everything the same. It wasn't de-differentiated, it makes them all one country. This is exactly what they seem to do to us by saying that basically anything that's theoretically, anything that comes from white Western authors is inherently evil. This really inverts the structure of power relations. This really flips sides of racism, which makes them the oppressor then becomes the enemy. Exterminated, it needs to be annihilated. It's the same kind of logic that's used to oppress people in the status quo. All and that, or basically all art and our.
Yeah.
Thus, our response basically to the host is why we affirm your advocacy. We say to bring in DuPont and Chabert, but infuse debate with that. The revolutionary aesthetic. Revolutionary aesthetics, what we'll always say, yeah.
What kind of questions are you on? Alright. You've got a strategic evidence, right?
Yeah.
So, how does Zizek's identity play a role in his theories for the liberation of the oppressed?
Well, Zizek was also from Eastern Europe, he's from Slovenia.
I understand, but how does this play a role in the black liberation, Latino liberation, Asian liberation from oppression?
Well, we believe that it allows for the oppression. Remember what? They're right from a specific condition where they were oppressed. They were being oppressed by, the Soviet Union.
Okay, that's
and they were
without
the right strategies to combat that.
So how is that conducive for people of color?
Our argument is to endorse your advocacy. It's just we have to create this critical implosion. We use this theory in this
room.
We should have the logic of the ballot. How debate operates
to determine final decisions and
authorizes your racism.
Let me ask you a question about implosion. Explain to me how the methodology of implosion, what that looks like, and how that transforms the conditions that we agree are problematic.
Very simple. The implosion occurs on the ballot. The act of...
So the ballot transforms... racism.
No, the ballot implodes the bar that separates the affirmative and negative. It separates
what about the binary
position. The logic that drives competition, which must privilege one identity over another, which one person must always
be. I understand how you deal with that, but I'm asking how does that translate into changing the material conditions that we talk about? I understand all the rupturing metaphysics and oppressive ontology. I understand it. I'm asking you, how does that translate into changing the material conditions that we agree are oppressive?
By doing what you do. The 1C is an endorsement of your advocacy. It talks about how the only thing we add to it is that critical implosion in debate to challenge how debate forces to operate in the same kind of binary fashion, which produces the over under, and then it authorizes racism and it allows for the extermination and the appropriation of the other.
Okay, you made
a revolution in debate. That's where we start. We start by challenging the binary logic of competition, not really incorporating people. That's
all right. So where was the Native American on the strike sheet?
What's that?
Where was the Native American judge on the strike sheet?
I don't know. That's my point.
Okay, so how is that a practice that says that we're being exclusionary of other racial groups if they weren't on the prep sheet? We're talking about a specific instance where a black woman was on a prep sheet and you chose to strike her. How is that connection to what your argument is about?
Our argument that was not done out of attempt to eliminate race. It wasn't an attempt to say that,
of course your intentions weren't that, but the implications were that. But at the same time, what we're asking
the implications
is that
aren't necessarily that.
Okay. I don't see any black faces.
Let me ask a question real quick. You make a bunch of arguments about the usefulness of identity politics. How are identity politics situated in relation to your advocacy? How are identity politics situated in relation to your advocacy?
It's not identity politics, it's identity in politics. You know, these identities that we have and prescribed to us are from the colonizer that have been imposed upon us. I am not Indian. That was an identity that was used by the colonizer to describe those peoples. And thus, I will use that identity to challenge those struggles, but I will not basically say, this is what I am.
Okay.
This is not the NDT round a few years ago where Louisville got totally fucked. We're not up here saying, oh, you all know us at our core. war. We're not really racist or anything like that. Our argument in here is that saying that we should prep Shannara just because she is black is the same as saying, well, just vote for us in this round because we're black. That reduces the complexity of people and everything to a mere object that would be affirmed. That is the exact thing that we should all be trying to fight against in debates like this one. Our program has a long history of standing alongside marginalized groups and affirming them and advancing causes through the means of debate and through the ways in which we engage in debate practices. This means that the ways in which they go about debating in this round are one that pit ideologies and certainly aligned groups against one another, which actually hinders the process of racial inclusion in here. This is why Ben Garoche won against them in prelims, because they marginalized other groups to an extent that was absolutely unbelievable. This means that they privilege one group over another. This is the same AFNED binary that we're talking about in this debate round. Until we challenge debate structures, we're not going to be able to challenge race and things like that in this round. Also, they talk about how they mirror the community in the 1AC. Of course, we're all products of the community in which we're in. However, that doesn't mean that they're necessarily getting the same experience that we talk about through our Zubanchich evidence, because the implosion has to come from the structure of an edge. This is why they can't double themselves Zubanchich 03. When Nietzsche begins his preface to Ecce Homo with the question, who am I? This question is to be situated alongside Zarathustra's words, alas, is it my word, who am I? From the passage above, at this point his work, Nietzsche feels ready to answer this question in the following perhaps surprising way. I know both, I am both, I am double. The edge of this doubleness or duplicity is what Nietzsche will ultimately hold to be his greatest invention of creation. He emerges too as a doubleness, only from within this very break that takes place with and because of Nietzsche's declaring, and Nietzsche will transform the two ones into a twofold face. Mercer combined is the shortest distance between two names and what they connote. The shortest distance between two is precisely this edge, as we shall see. The edge is the only possible location for what is designated as beyond good and evil, and thus is not really a realm and not a beyond in the common sense of the term, but rather it has the structure of an edge. The event Nietzsche is precisely this edge. This is the line that divides 1AC, 1NC, affirmative, negative, the actual slash between the two. We implode that in order to create a space that would actually allow more inclusion into debate. Ultimately, they talk about how we can include multiple perspectives and things like that. If this eventually morphs into a permutation, this would actually just be mimesis, a play within a play within a play. Zubanchich 03. There exists something else besides the couple formed by, on one hand, the classical metaphysical position which exempts the real from speech, and on the other hand, the so-called sophistic position which tries to undermine the very notion of the real. But something else exists because this alternative is precisely duality, a duality that has nothing to do with the dichotomies between complementary oppositional terms, which are ultimately two sides of the same one. This duality is not yet multiplicity either. It's perhaps best articulated in the topology of an edge whose sole substantiality consists of simultaneously separating and linking two surfaces. A specific duality aims for the real and makes it take place through the very split that gives structure to this duality. It is a duality that simultaneously constitutes a cause in the advent and the consequence of the real, but also a duality that thereby captures or expresses the real. A very good example of this kind of doubleness would be the famous play scene in Shakespeare's Hamlet. Obviously, the play within a play does not have the same structure, logic, and impact as it would have, for instance, the play within a play within a play within a play. Not only is this the case that two are enough, but further multiplication or mirroring would clearly lead to an entirely different configuration, that of an endless metonymic illusion in Hamlet, the redoubling of fiction, far from avoiding or lacking the real functions, is the very trap of the real. One could also say that the mousetrap in Hamlet is exactly the status of the declaration of the declaration. Through the station of the murder of Gonzago, Hamlet declares what was declared to him by his father's ghost. At the same time, this declaration of the declaration taking the form of stage performance succeeds precisely because it produces a dimension of I, the real, am speaking. This is what allows us to throw the murderous king off balance. This is going to argue against any kind of arguments that they make about like how they're going to redouble in this round or anything like that, or any kind of tricks like that. Simply, once that jarring experience already happens, then it can't necessarily happen again. It wouldn't have that same kind of impact. It wouldn't get that benefit. Also, the permutation can't solve because of the system of mimicry grounded in ressentiment and slave morality we're taking for an attempt to read sameness between us while eliminating otherness. This is Islam 01. It's never a question of two or more stable subjects with their fixed and essential fixed identities, which Deleuze calls molar, mimicking one another. The mimicry between stable subjects keeps their fixity in place and leaves ample room for the same to appropriate the other by turning its relative difference through the dialectical analogy of its own concepts. It brings into play the master/slave dialectic from the self-relational mastery of the other through analogical differentiation or othering and its attendant ressentiment. With the ambit of the parallel evolution, there's no room for the encounter to take place. More crucially, though, a parallel evolution signals a composite process which involves both rigid subjectivity and the molar type and desubjectified individualization of the molecular type. In addition to the slavery of the argument's turning case, it also proves that they minimize the difference between the two of us, which is ultimately the kind of fix that they're trying to argue against. hint in this debate round, and here's more Islam evidence on that question. He says, when the encounter takes place between two or more parties who maintain their absolute difference from each other, what is required to form a single becoming is not a recognition, but a differential repetition. In other words, it's never a question of mimicry, whereas we've seen the molar subject either absorbs the other in its own form or is absorbed, reproducing the same old fixed positions rather than de-stratifying them. Instead of repetition, Deleuze and Watcher propose doubling as a mode of repetition proper to the eight parallel evolution. They evaluate mimicry as being a bad concept since it relies on binary logic to describe the phenomenon of an entirely different nature. On the other hand, doubling is a non-binary differential mode of repetition, which instead of reproducing the model and like its rhetorical counterpart of the simulacrum, overturns both the model and the copy. This deterritorialization of the mimetic model releases the molecular force of becoming, otherwise which Nietzsche would call eternal repetition. This is another place in which, like, if they try to extrapolate any kind of permutation out of that, then they're ultimately going to be eliminating the otherness. Our speech has all been an exaltation of their arguments and a castigation of the way that they've been deployed. Basically, we're just saying that if you're going to alienate your biggest allies in the debate community, then your strategy is going to lose and you're not advancing just causes of the oppressed.
How much time do you
have? I have 9:40.
I am a Black Panther at the backstabbers and dream snatchers. Watch your ass, I'm finna catch you. I ain't coming soft porn. I'm fucking you hardcore, my brown skin and redirection. I'll start off your intersection. You probably take me literal, but listen for a while. I'll have a penetration of the mind through revolutionary style. Other projects can hold a candle to our metaphors, pull forth from Allah. Have you screaming, oh my, and your God. Time to lay down your cards for a house to go fish. Our resistance is consistent, we rarely ever miss. I wish you could understand, so let me explain what they don't actually increase a frame rate to increase the liberation of the press in this actual day. Now, we furthermore isolate a lot of disadvantages to the type of to their type of advocacy. Number one is that the fact that they exclusionary in the first distance of this debate round, we felt that was a unique moment where they could have had a chance to actually have a critique of how a person of color from a Black existence feel about the arguments that their mentor, that Charles Mills talks about when they never look at the ideal body as anybody else within this activity. We felt that they're still the ideal theory as a diss, and if their ideal theory is not able to access the race criticism of white supremacy, they're not able to access our type of approach. They cannot mirror us. For instance, the fact that they never spoke to the unique experience of white supremacy within the context of how what it is to be a Black person, they can never do that in the sense that they always try to foreground their type of advocacy to hear the voice of Shannara. And then we furthermore also think that the bell hooks argument that talks about how their type of arguments only speak to a specialized audience that only reinscribes the same mass narratives that they speak of. The nihilo evidence was out of the one they see conceded. The fact that they can never they cannot assume all of the arguments that we talk about. Group the last arguments that they talk about within their one AR that talks about how we can never do this, but at the same time our neo-law evidence talks about how the complete is the book this both and names a moment within the complete assimilation of racial African-American others altogether conveniently closes that web of debate by totalizing and smoothing over all the categories involved to take account for the culture of the coming. We cannot merely go from a dialectical separation of either or to a dialectical assimilation of both, and it's exactly what their strategy does, and it's a disadvantage to them, only increasingly linking them to the whites that are not able to address these type of things. We are the mirror. We cannot mirror a mirror, because the fact that you cannot mirror the Blackness within the system, within the binary that it is to be Black. Now, furthermore, when we look to their arguments off the top of the flow, yes, we understand that there were no Native Americans within the type of advocacy they talk about. We understand his stories to the forefront, but we're talking about a unique experience that they have right now to actually hear the voice of a Black woman. We did not have the unique experience to hear the voice of a Native American within the system. We've read about their type of identity politics critique of us is the one that Bell Hooks talks about in 90. This is the critique of identity is irrelevant to the renewed Black liberation struggles, all imposed the problematic ways. Given the erasing politics of white supremacy, which seeks to prevent the foundation of radical Black self-esteem, you cannot commonly dismiss the concern with identity politics. Any critic as one, the racial potential of postmodernism as it relates to racial difference and racial domination with a need to consider implication of critique identity for the oppressed groups is exactly a distance to that type of alternative. They can never be able to address this. We did not. They also don't have a concrete methodology with their doing it, so don't ever get here and try to claim and extrapolate these type of arguments. Also, group all these group the top identity politics argument that they talk about, which said that, you know, we have to be identity and politics is exactly what we are, because our methodology is using a revolutionary aesthetic that's able to allow people to self-determine their own type of identity, not imposing a Black aesthetic on them. Group all of their binary arguments, because one, we do not preclude a discussion about other forms of oppression. As Mills, evidence is indicative to white supremacy, the root of all oppression, we challenge this. Two, race-based policies are essential component of this discussion. We need to always be from the social context and be happy to be black men, and our starting point can't be from other social contexts. Three, identity politics, bad arguments are the tool of white supremacy. Focus on those discussions to the backdoor politics is exactly what historically has happened when people wanted to discuss the actual issue of race. Four, they read and speak from a place of purpose that actually caused this type of discussion of race in the first place in any context, but not needs to be a blanket label about oppression is what they argue. When they have never fully experienced what it is to be black and what it is means to be one of those type of oppressed identities and locations, they can only increase the white aesthetic and only allow those type of burdens and oppression because that binary is something that's inflicted upon me and Dayvon's identity. Also, that another link to the white aesthetic is the whole notion that they can do our plan they can do our stuff with voting negative. We think that's totally ridiculous. There's no office in this position. You might just as well vote F for the type of argument. Also, there's no solvency. They have no talking methodology actually addressing the fundamental issue of race and gender and class and all those things that are interconnected, because the type of theory and Nietzsche evidence as well as the Zizek evidence do not outline a specific way how we can break down oppression within from an oppressed group. Also, we think the belly for us is the better reference to the very metaphysics that they are seeking to transform. We are the way that has the possibility of transforming material conditions that we are for the ontology that they actually criticize. We can actually increase it through looking at our actual change of epistemology with this activity. Talking about the Spanos argument that says that we can be a prerequisite engagement in how we don't export people out to the world to make these imperialist type of policies. Also, they can see that the new evidence that says that anything that comes out of the white aesthetic, it must be destroyed. We furthermore think that they are not able to access that type of solvency if they can see that argument. Also, when our big crosses did not beat us in the fucking prelim debate, you're thinking about Towson JM. Also, we're not saying that this is the NDT realm that's talking about these type of things. They can't mirror the state about our paralysis. If they want to try to mirror us, they only leave us in a state of paralysis and never get to address the identities and the problems that we exist. Now, we also already grouped the arguments to the last part of what they are, but actually stand across the kneel on evidence again and talks about how their type of approach will only be complete assimilation. It doesn't truly allow us to break down those type of binaries. We don't flip the binaries. We say we solve for them. We're able to access these things through the Mills evidence that talks about how we need to stand against the alignment of white supremacy, because the white supremacy is the one that has created this concession. They conceded this evidence out of the one they see. We feel that we must be able to analyze ourselves and look at the racial oppression and how we can actually break those down. And they can't do that by their first exclusion act of Chenier.
They're right that I don't have any idea what it means to be black. I can never even compare or even begin to understand what their experience is like. Just like they can never experience what it was like for me to have my culture taken from me. To have my great grandfather tell me that I'm not an Indian because my great grandmother denounced my heritage. It's not a reason to vote just because of those issues. Debate is driven by the competitive desire to dominate, to construct one identity over another, to privilege one over the other. We call for you to endorse the affirmative by voting negative. This allows us to frustrate the binary logic of either or. It allows us to open up a space for rethinking of how debate operates. It challenges our common perception of what it means to win, what it means to have an advocacy, what it means to actually increase minority participation in debate. There are barriers that we have to challenge, which is driven by the competitive desire of this activity. There are constant calls to vote for them just because they have a good idea, or just because they want to increase their participation in debate. It's not going to be responsible. The fact that's going to merely replicate the current binary logic. It basically is the notion of competitive desire, which is the background of the reasons why they're not always in debate, why they're able to be eliminated from our rounds, why the judging panel is the way it is. It's all driven through this state of competition. Our whole notion of having you endorse their advocacy through this shatters that perception of debate, and it challenges all our arguments. We have a few reasons why this is good. The first is going to be our identity in politics argument. Mignolo is not some postmodern author. He's from Venezuela, and he is essentially a Latina scholar who attempts to find ways to challenge current arguments. And his argument basically is that we can never achieve liberation until we realize that these identities that we have are not our own. They have instead been imposed upon us. I was not native until the white people came over and colonized my people and said, "You are native," or "you are Indian," and then ascribed an identity to me. Until I acknowledge that identity has been imposed upon me, then I can never achieve liberation. I must realize that it has been prescribed to me, and once I do that, I can then use identity to challenge the current systems. Until I acknowledge that, I'm always going to be replicating a form of domination and imperialism which cannot be challenged. We're not saying they can't have an identity. We just said the identity has to be, we have to acknowledge that it's oppressive. We have to find ways to use it strategically to challenge those notions. The point that they never once acknowledge that their identity is basically has been imposed upon them, that it has been forced, and that because they can use it liberatory, it means they're still still going to challenge the current notions of how modern white aesthetic operates. They will still be continuing that legacy. The second argument we have is going to be our notion of the response of mock terms. They want to get up here and they want to blame us for the fault of racism. They want to blame us for not allowing minorities to be participating in debate. They want to blame our notion of racism because we don't put them in impressionary this round as a reason for us to lose. This is merely the attempt for them to assign guilt and blame, which we can then be called for our eradication. They call for the ballot because they think we're racist. This is the imposing of impunity of motive on us, and which they can assign us an identity, they can ascribe to us an identity and tell us what we are, what we mean to do, or what we have done. This is the exact same kind of logic which authorized for the colonialization of peoples, and it authorized the years of violence in which we go over their culture, and we name them, we tell them what they are, and we assign them. Our call is to shed those notions of imperialism, to not attempt to label the other, to not attempt to appropriate the other for our own good. This is also argued about the whole notion of how they operate in the binary constructions. They are constantly approaching one identity over the other. Their call essentially does not ever include the binary that separates the white aesthetic from the black aesthetic. It really seeks to erase the white aesthetic, to eliminate it, to eradicate it. All that does is create a constant cycle of inversion which allows for domination and oppression. It's not going to blow that bar and realize that spaces where the edges touch, where one becomes two is essentially that space for rethinking. It's a shattering of what divides the us from them. It shatters the self-other dichotomy which allows for us to actually challenge the current notions to challenge the current barriers which prevent minorities from actually being this activity. Furthermore, they have the notion of the marginalization of being commotion. Their whole arguments out there is about how we should increase minority participation in debate. But they ignore the fact that Ben and Crouch beat them because they did not incorporate Native Americans, that they denied them their identity in those rounds. And the point is, they say that, oh no, we didn't lose to them. We don't even acknowledge that loss. Is the point that they don't, whether they basically use this form of identity as merely a way to marginalize us. They want to use it as a way to say that it's not all inclusive strategy, but instead it's a way for them to basically say that their identity is privileged. It's not forms that identity is interconnected. That their thing is basically that only their forms of resistance is a form of struggle, it's a good struggle. This is the analysis, this kind of advocacy is what pits us against one another. Look, we love this team. Their 1AC is amazing. I don't even know what's going on. We've always had a great relationship. I love you guys. I consider you best friends. When you guys won the run against KU, we came running over from our room to give you hugs and to congratulate you. We were stoked about debating them. We did not want to alienate them. We did not want to pit them against one another. We are not attempting to engage in some kind of privileged notion of identity, but we must realize that they're attempting to dichotomous thought, and which they classify all of our authors as essentially postmodern, is the same kind of de-differentiated violence which we indict, tell the Soviet Union authors attempt to control them by taking all of Europe and basically taking all these different peoples and saying you are all one, you are all a certain group. This is the same kind of appropriation of identity which allows and authorizes them to construct these binary terms. Our argument we've never even used again postmodern authors. All of our arguments have essentially been through Mingelo or from Dupontius, which is attempting to challenge the current struggle that she was going through in Slovenia, the pressure that was occurring because of the Soviet Union. Their attempts to ignore how the binary are constructed between the United States and Russia that authorized the appropriation. It's not just a Western aesthetic, but it's an aesthetic that is based upon the appropriation of identity, of deep differentiating entire peoples, and then exterminating them.
Chapter 16.
They conceded our framework that says that this debate should be about who best engages in the consistent practice and action that advances liberation of the oppressed. The argument is that we have a specific methodology can have a concrete way of achieving concrete change to the way in which we engage this activity. Our argument is that revolutionary aesthetics are losses in this activity, but challenge the assumptions that we have in ways that it promotes the white supremacist epistemology and the white aesthetic from which the neo evidence says nothing meaningful can come out of. As a result, this means we have a specific ideology and a methodology that can transform these type of conditions. Their argumentation about implosion of these binaries don't have any specific way in which they affect the material conditions that exist. I also have a particular one in which their method can transform material conditions, and this is why you reject the negative team. Our argument is that they make these arguments about how the binaries create the forms of domination that exist. First of all, we better challenge these forms of domination as a result of the way in which we engage in this activity, as a result of using revolutionary aesthetics to challenge the forms of domination. And also, the argument they kind of talked about at the top. Our argument isn't that just vote for us because we're black, but we talk about the ways the somatic norms that exist in this activity create the kind of white aesthetic that normalizes the white body and oftentimes excludes people of color from being able to engage in these conversations. Our argument is that if we really want to use the ballot effectively, we need to rupture the somatic norms that causing the type of oppression that exists in our society. So they make these arguments about how this kind of desire for competition creates the propensity for domination. Our argument is that we better challenge these binaries by using revolutionary aesthetics and starting with the black aesthetic. It gives us the ability to rupture the already impending binaries that exist right now. We challenge the very phenomenon, the very phenomenon from which creates these binaries. The Mills evidence says that white supremacy is a political system from which all others are highlighted, which means that the binaries that are imposed upon us come as a result of white supremacy. If we look at our time and space right now, the ideal theory from which their arguments depend on, a theory that doesn't recognize the kind of white supremacist society that we live in. It's atemporal and ahistorical. It has no way to be applied to the specific. This is the Mills evidence that I talk about in the 2EC, my partner talks about in the 1ER, that talks about it doesn't have a way to actually deal with the world as it is. And so we have to be able to change the fundamental conditions that exist. We can't just rely on ideal theory that has a lot of metaphysical and logical ways in which to challenge forms of domination, but aren't concrete enough. They make argument, these identity politics arguments. Look, we recognize that black has been something that the colonialists have put upon us. We use that as a means to be able to transform the conditions of our society, recognizing that within a white supremacist society, we're identified as black, and using that to challenge those very binaries that have been as a result. Also, the revolutionary aesthetics argument that we talk, our advocacy is about revolutionary aesthetics. It allows any individual to embrace an aesthetic that is challenging the kind of dominant white Western aesthetic that Neil says nothing meaningful can come out of, which means the individual can self-determine the way in which they engage in the activity. If someone wants to engage in a feminist aesthetic, or wants to engage in a Native American aesthetic, or an Asian aesthetic, these are things in which we would advocate for under our revolutionary aesthetic that would allow people to self-determine their educational process in a way in which they can challenge these particular forms of domination. They make arguments about how our argument actually this blame argument, that because of the fact that they impression error and blame them, and therefore it doesn't allow us to challenge white supremacy. Look, our argument is that, as the Wise evidence talks about, there needs to be more voices of people of color and voices that don't usually get heard in order for this activity to produce the type of education that can be transformative. Our argument, and look, we're not saying that there are racists that you had bad intentions. Our argument is that when dealing with racism in a white supremacist society, we have to be conscious of race in the way in which it implicates the type of discussions that we have. If we don't think about those things, it becomes problematic in dealing with politics. So what we're saying is that you have to have these things as a part of your political strategy or continue the invisibility of the voices that we talk about, the Archie the Messenger, a lyrical lyricist, the Lauren Hill that my partner played in the 1NC, and his poetry that was in the 1ER. These are things that get silenced as a result of the exclusion of race in a white supremacist society. This is the other Mills evidence system. Must be a global theoretical framework that situates discussions on white racism and white supremacy in order to understand the political dynamics that exist right now. Also, the Nealon evidence that they didn't talk about talks about the ways in which that oftentimes these kind of the binaries where they seek to destroy oftentimes cause the elimination of the African-American otherness altogether, creates that kind of, that increase that kind of either or dilemma that is actually more dangerous than the dilemma itself. And so our argument is that we have to deal with the issues of white supremacy within the context of society we live in order to effectively transform it. At the point to where they make these arguments about how one identity is used to overthrow the other, as a result of engaging in revolutionary aesthetics, it's not about one aesthetic dominating the other, but rather the individual using their own social location to produce an aesthetic that can challenge the dominant white Western aesthetic, and they can see that the white Western aesthetic is the one that is permeating throughout the entire society. The argument is to challenge that we have to use our own social location and create aesthetics that can transform the type of education that comes out of this activity so that we can have an epistemology that can challenge forms of domination, or else, as the Spanos evidence suggests, it'll prop up the neoconservative agenda that causes the type of imperialist policies that cause people to suffer all over the world. They also make this argument about our loss to Oklahoma is because we didn't include Native Americans. They were negative. They ran war on terror. It wasn't give back the land. So that was out of context. Also, the part of the way they make arguments about how they also make these arguments about how the authors aren't postmodern. Zizek is definitely one of those postmodern theorists. Nietzsche is probably one of those postmodern theorists. And the argument is that those individuals with a dove in the realm of ideal theory that we talk about, it links to the ideal theory in which this ideal theory is what the white aesthetic is. It is that aesthetic that doesn't allow us to deal with the actual material conditions that exist. At the point to where it's necessary for us to confront the privilege, they make arguments about alienating people and alienating them, teach us from being able to build coalitions. Look, our argument is at the point to where Shannara was not on the panel, then that was already a rupture of the coalition that is necessary to challenge these forms of domination. It is necessary in order to challenge white supremacy and have the voices of those individuals who are marginalized by white supremacy in the conversation. And like we said before, Shannara is well-read on a lot of the literature that you talk about and read, and so her voice from a perspective of an African-American or a black person in the United States is necessary in order to have an effective conversation about these things. So what you have at the end of the debate is that as the affirmative who has the ability to challenge these forms of domination in a more concrete way, the mirroring has no specific methodology from which they can transform those forms of domination. So you vote affirmative to be able to better embrace these binaries. Voting neg and then doing the doubling thing doesn't give us the methodology necessary to transform those conditions. It only diverts us and it keeps white supremacy intact because it keeps the invisibility of people of color who are necessary in challenging white supremacy.